Olá a todos e todas, bem-vindos ao Mostra Conversa, o espaço de debate com os cineastas da 45ª Mostra de São Paulo. Hoje eu tenho o prazer de conversar com um grande cineasta canadense, Olivier Higgins, que está com um documentário na mostra, dirigido em conjunto com a Melanie Carrier, um documentário chamado Errantes, uma história Rohingya, um documentário que fala sobre o campo de refugiados de Kutupalong, que se tornou o maior campo de refugiados do mundo. São pessoas que fugiram do genocídio em Myanmar. Myanmar é um país do qual a gente fala pouco. Myanmar, ou Burma, ou Birmania, é um dos maiores países do Sudeste Asiático, faz fronteira com a China, com a Índia, com Bangladesh, e as pessoas fugiram de um verdadeiro massacre que aconteceu pelo governo de maioria budista em cima da minoria muçulmana. Então, esses muçulmanos conseguiram migrar para esse campo que fica em Bangladesh. E o filme mostra o Kalam, o Muhammad, outros personagens, né, outras pessoas que moram lá hoje em dia. E o filme retrata um pouco do dia a dia desse campo de refugiados. Olivier, thank you very much for being with us at São Paulo Festival.
Thank you.
So, I'd like you to start explaining a little bit for our viewers, because we have quite a few knowledge about Southeastern Asia, and especially Myanmar. It's not a very well-known country. So tell us a little bit about the recent Myanmar's history, and how did events in Myanmar led to the creation of the refugee camp?
I'll do a really short resume, but so Myanmar is a country like between Bangladesh and Thailand, China, as you said, I think. Like there are 135, more than 135 ethnical let's say tribes in different tribes in Myanmar, and it's mostly Buddhist there, but one of the population there are Rohingyas, and since many years they have not been accepted as a citizen of the country. So the militaries, the government decided to expose the Rohingyas, so the Rohingyas had to flee the countries. There were many violence like situation where like in some years they had to flee the country, but in 2012 and blah blah blah. But in 2017, the military attacks the villages and the people, and like many people had to flee the country, and many of them fled to the Bangladesh, which is just the country just beside. And so people were entering like 10, 20,000 per day to Bangladesh. So in 1 year, the small refugee camp of Kutupalong, because the camp was there, that refugee camp was there since the 90, the 90s, and it became in 1 year, it passed from 20,000 people or 30,000 people to, more than 1 million people. So it was a really important crisis.
Okay, and today, I don't know if we've got the recent numbers, but in the few months, we may say that still the camp has about 700,000 people or even more.
It's a lot. It's more than 700,000 people. And there are a few camps around that areas. In the south of Bangladesh, there are more than millions of Rohingyas over there. But in specifically in that Kutupalong camp, it's a little bit more than 700,000, I think.
Okay, and I was reading that this year, like in the beginning of this year, there was another coup d'etat, another movement of the military right there on Myanmar.
Because it's I won't go into that politics stuff, and in the film is not about, we really wanted to go out of this track, related to the history and of the Rohingya and the conflicts and things like that. We wanted to go out of this cold part. But yes, there were coup d'etat because the military just took the power again.
Okay. Let's stop the hard news. Let's talk about the documentary. I really enjoyed. I like very much the way you show us kind of a sense of time and the rhythm. We may dive a little bit during an hour and a half in this refugee camp and their routine, how they live down there. So I'd like to like you to tell us a little bit what you and Melanie saw. What were the most positive and negative things you saw at the camp? Did you see many people deprived of food, water, work, and all?
Mm-hmm. So just to start, like me and Melanie are partners for a long time. We've been working together, like we live together and we are a couple. But she didn't come with me on the ground. So I went on the ground with the documentary photographer, Renaud Philippe, who did most of the images of the film. And he's been documenting refugee camps for years. And the project started because we saw his work, photographic work. He's a photographer, and we went back there together to at first to do just a short film. You know, we proposed him to go back and do a short film, and then the project got bigger after a few days because I saw it was so important and so powerful to bring back those testimonies and the idea of the film was to do something different than the media can do usually. So we, as I said, we didn't want to go into politics and things like this. We really wanted to feel the camp, live the camp, feel the life also over there, because sometimes we talk about tragedies and it goes fast, you know, with the news, and it's just a few minutes, you know, like, oh, the car accident over there, and then 50 person died there because of the explosion of this, and then like we are bombarded every day with the news from local news or national news, and it's hard to understand the scale of the thing and to feel that there are really human beings behind all those events, and that was the idea of the film, you know, to feel those people alive there, see the kids play, see, so to go beyond only the facts of history and politics. So we really wanted to feel what it is to, what are the human conditions over there. So it's a film about human conditions and the consequences of a situation like this in a refugee camp, like Kutupalong. So that's the whole idea of the film, you know, being immersed in that camp and really feel the ghost that all those refugees can have on their shoulders.
Okay, I know what you mean, because of course those people are victims of something tragic, but they also keep going, right? And they find the strength to build their lives there and try to continue, right? And I think your film helps us not to see them only as victims of a tragedy. They are people building a community, right?
It's a film also about human resilience, you know, like how life want to live, you know. So it's a film about kids that don't know. Like the narrator of the film is Mohamed Shafi Ronga that live here in Quebec nearby. He's a good friend now, and you know, he's been living 18 years in the camp, and then in that camp, Kutupalong. And he said, when I was a kid, you know, it was the most beautiful life I could dream of. Like I was for him, he had good time there, and he missed the camp. It's strange, the paradox. It's strange to hear that, you know, like that was his life. That was life. He didn't understand. Like we don't have food. That's life, you know. Like, and he was going to play with his friends, you know. And but life was really hard. But and it's growing up that yes, you play in the mud with your kids, with your friends, soccer, but you start to realize the outside world and what is the life and what will be your life. And so that's what he told us, you know, the passage between this young age and this naive situation of the resilience of saying, okay, that's what am I, a refugee, you know?
Sure. Yeah, I remember one of the people in the narration, he or she, I don't remember, it exposes this ambivalence. Like, of course, they are happy to build a community there, but it seems like for refugees, there is always some kind of void or anguish of not being there. Some people say, of course, I would like to be there, right? That there is this, sometimes this wish, a permanent wish to go back. I don't know, to try to reconnect with it, with their nation, right? Does it exist?
About Shofi, like, it's for him, I was asking him for another project. I was asking him, you never really lived in Burma, you know? His story, it's not in the film, but if to answer your question, for him, he lived only 1 year. He left Burma when he was one, and he went to the refugee camp. And he grew up 18 years in the refugee camp. Then he moved to Canada. And it was interesting to hear him saying, you know, like, for me, I never had a nation. I never had a country, you know. Like, now he started to feel citizen of here. You know, he said, I'm Canadian and I'm happy. He always dreamed of going back to his home place where his parents talked about that for 18 years of his life. You know, that's our home is there. So he always dreamed of seeing his home, to have a home, you know.
Yeah.
So that was.
You talked about, is it Hafi, right? Hafi?
It's Mohamed Shofi. It's hard to understand like why there's a narrator and it's not Kalam, who's we follow the Kalam poems and the poetry and the story in the film. So Kalam was our guide, our translator, our sound man also sometimes in the camp. So it really helped us in the camp, and at one point, because we were writing poetry and we really wanted the film to be poetic, and that was the whole idea of the film. And we asked him, can we follow your story? And because his story also was interesting, about you know, like him fleeing Burma to India and going back in the camp and things like this. And so we asked him if we could listen to his story in the film. But after that, you know, it was complicated to go back to record a narration in the camp. It was harder to get in the camp. And also there's so much noise in the camp that it's hard to get a good narration. And we met Shofi here in Canada. And Shofi at one point, he was helping us for translation and things like this. And we realized his voice was really special. And we started to have this idea of that Shofi would narrate Kalam's poem and Kalam's story, you know. And it was really emotional for Shofi to narrate the film, because you know, he's been living there for 18 years, you know. So it was like if he was narrating his own story. And I can tell something about also the you know, the Rohingya, about the narration, because Rohingya is a oral language, you know, you cannot write Rohingya. So it was really special, because it started to be written, but like Kalam don't write Rohingya, Shofi don't write Rohingya. And so when we were here, all the narration was in English, you know, and we wanted the narration to be in Rohingya. So we decided to do that narration at home, to be not in a studio where it's expensive. So we built a small studio here at home, and to feel comfortable and to take time. And Shofi had to really read the narration in English, like one sentence, and translate on the spot in Rohingyas, because he could not write, you know, the narration. He had to read and say, okay, I'll say this like this, okay. And then do the translator right away. And I was saying, you know, like, oh, it's maybe a little bit too long, or he was saying, oh, it's a Bengali word, it's not a Rohingya word, I'll do it again. So, and it was really, really, that all the, that it was really powerful for, and hard also for him to go into that mood of feeling those emotions. And sometimes he was crying, we had to stop because he was crying, you know? So all that, I think we can feel that he's really, when he narrate the story, he's there, you know? And that's his story also.
Okay. Let me ask you, how many times have you and Melanie have been to Kutupalong? Only once or sometimes?
So, as I said at the beginning, like, Melanie didn't come to Kutupalong. We were talking every day on the phone, and then she worked with me here when I went back. I was back here, and I went there with Renaud to film, and then we were there for a bit less than a month. And Renaud was there for his photographic report like half a year earlier. So he already had a contact with Kalam, and we discussed, you know, about some places. And I saw the picture also that he took. So that helped us a lot to have this contact with Kalam. And he was really already a friend and involved in the process. So that was a lot easier. And Kalam lived in, he's a Rohingya living in the camp. So it's pretty rare that, you know, sometimes people come a few days to film and they have a fixer from outside, you know, Bengali person going in the camp. But with Kalam, we were with his friend, his family, you know, during the shoot. So we were stopping at the friend's place. And then, so it all became kind of organic going around his life. Yeah.
Okay. And last, Olivier, I'd like to ask you about, I think there's a very important sequence more to the end of your film about women, showing women in the camp. And it always reminds me of this idea that normally wars are not, they are not made by women. It's something that drag them to a change in their lives. Most of them tell their traumas, right? Some violent episodes they lived still in Burma. And I'd like you to speak about the women you knew at the camp, because they seem to be like real heroes that were dragged by the war, as it usually happens with other wars too.
I'm not sure to understand your question, but yes, if you want to talk about the women and how I, it's sure that they've been raped. Many of them have been raped, and they also lost their children, and so, and their voice. We really, they were the person that really that really wanted to talk, maybe, or sometimes they came to us and said, yeah, they saw we were filming, and they said I want to say something also, and it was not, maybe did not happen that much with men. I don't know, maybe that's the way it worked. Or because I saw other reports and there are men talking also, and but the whole film was linked to the you know, the child for us, you know, that the what is the part, our child being born in the camp, and they do not ask for all this, you know, they are born without any nation, you know, without a passport. And And for us, that idea of the child being there, growing up there, was important. And maybe that's what you felt, that it's linked, that's it directly linked with the mother also. I don't know.
Sure. No, the impression I got is that normally kids somehow they were born there. They just lived in Burma for a year, as you told, and then they start their lives building a new perspective. And the adults, like the adult women, they lived a lot of traumas. They remember a lot how it was in the original country, right? They saw some kids being killed. Yeah. There are some traumatic episodes, as I saw in some of them. Relate. I really enjoyed that sequence about women. I think there are two or three of them talking, narrating.
Yeah. Okay. You mean the kind of build up where for us. At first, we wanted to enter slowly in the camp, you know, to feel more and more and more and more and more people, and at that point, we hear all the voices coming up and coming up and coming up, and we see the camp for the first time in a way, and the scale of the camp, and for us. We could have put those voices at the beginning, you know. And when we talk about when we thought about making a short film at the beginning, we didn't want any tragic testimonies, you know. We wanted to really to feel the people living there, and we want to see the people alive in their daily life. But at one point, when you start to talk to people, and we are not ready, and they start to cry and to share their stories, and you say it's so powerful. We you know, we need to present that to the world, and they had something to say. So we have a responsibility in a way, and but we could have put that, all those testimonies at the beginning of the film, but we put that further at the end because we wanted to go in the camp and then be ready as a viewer to receive all those testimonies and then feel the scale. And at that point, I think you feel that all the voices are, it could be any one of them, you know, it could be Kalam, it could be this person, and they are talking about the same thing. They're all one, you know?
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay. Olivier, I'd like you to thank you very much for the conversation. I don't know if you know that, but Mostra, São Paulo Festival, is in its 45th edition. It's a very old festival, created in 1977. And last year, because of the pandemics, we had our first totally online edition. And this year is the first hybrid edition, both with screenings in theaters and online. And we are very happy to present your film in both. So we're going to have screenings in theaters, but also some screenings at the SESC platform. SESC is a very precious partner of us, and SESC promotes free screenings for free. So your film will also be presented for free for those interested. And I think that is very democratic in a moment where in Brazil we have many economic difficulties for people that want to go to the movies but can't. So yeah, it's very precious to present your film in all platforms. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you. We are really happy to be part of the festivals. And if there's a website also, if you want to learn more, it's wanderingthemovie.com. So,
okay, great. So wandering with an A, right? W-A, not wandering.
Yeah. wanderingthemovie.com.
Wanderingthemovie.com. Okay, noted. Thank you very much, Olivier. See you next time.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.